Just got a quick announcement for you guys before we get into today's video. I'm coming at you from my beautiful backyard here. As you guys can see, this is my brassica bed full of amazing plants. Anyways, today we're not talking about the plants real quick. What I want to talk to you guys about are the cool Growing Your Greens t-shirts. You know, for those of you guys that are long-term brewers, you know that I had a one-time Growing Your Green t-shirt sale, and that money was destined to helping me have money to buy a farm, which I'll give an update in a minute. But since that time, the t-shirts are not available, and people ask, John, where can I get one of your t-shirts? And I say, sorry, that was like a one-time shot. So I want to let you guys know, for a limited time, we're bringing the t-shirts back again. So if you guys want to get one of these cool t-shirts, it's the dark navy with the green lettering, or actually my favorite color, the green t-shirt with the white lettering, you guys could now do that. So I'll post a link down below this video in the description so you guys can get your t-shirt. Also, I'll have a little link at the end of this video, at the end screen credits, so that you guys can link out and actually get a t-shirt. Now, I want to let you guys know that your purchase of a t-shirt goes directly to help me continue to produce, make, get videos edited and published for you guys. It takes a lot of my time, effort, and expense to make all that happen, and I've never asked for one penny from you guys, and I will never ask any money for you guys. But if you guys want to get a t-shirt where you get something, and then you want to help me also, please buy a t-shirt. They're really cool t-shirts. I got these specifically because I got them designed to fit, you know, me. And that's important, because a lot of t-shirts I go, if you go to some store, they're gonna fit kind of baggy, and I really don't like baggy t-shirts. So these ones are actually really nice fitting shirts. And I guess the last thing I wanna say is an update. So I've been searching for a property to buy. I use some of the t-shirt money plus some other money I have to put a down payment on a property. I'm into Puerto Rico, Hawaii, South Florida, a few other places. And basically, I decided on Puerto Rico, and then unfortunately, then the hurricane happened. So that kind of delayed that plan there, and now I'm probably gonna have to wait about 3 years before anything goes on further having to do with buying land in Puerto Rico. So meanwhile, I continue to look for property, and at this point, I'm probably looking at Hawaii. I need to make another trip over there, maybe possibly Maui. Anyways, on with today's show. Once again, if you want a t-shirt, check the link down below in the description. Get yours while they're up and available, because it may disappear at any time. Alright, this is John Cola with GrowingYourGreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you, and actually coming at you from one of my favorite farms here in South Florida. Actually, probably my favorite farm that I've actually visited this trip and actually on previous trips. I'll put links down below to some other videos I've made here at Swank Specialty Produce over the years. This farm, one of the reasons why I like it is because Darren, the farmer here, has been literally growing for the last 17 years on this land. And that's quite an impressive feat here in South Florida. You know, just with growing food, it's quite unfortunate that the market here in South Florida for homegrown style, you know, organically raised fruits and vegetables that haven't been sprayed chemical pesticides is actually quite small. And in my opinion, the market here in South Florida, there's so many people here, the market for the natural foods, you know, farm-grown foods, organic style foods needs to expand, because so many people are just in a box to, like, you know, go to Publix and get all their food, right? And they're really missing out on the high quality food. Actually, I was speaking with Darren, the farmer here, actually quite in depth for the last couple hours. So I have not enough time to film today for you guys, because like his youngest daughter, or his kid child, I forget if it's a boy or a girl, was only born when they started this farm. So the kids that they've raised have literally grown up on the farm. And he was saying that his daughter, you know, went out with like her friends or something to Chick-fil-A, and like she couldn't eat the Chick-fil-A because it's just not like super high quality, right? And it's just highly processed food, and not because like it doesn't taste good. I'm sure Chick-fil-A tastes good, but because she was raised and born on the farm and she knows good quality food. And it's quite unfortunate that most people, most Americans, don't know what good quality food is, because they keep eating the junk out of the grocery store, and especially here in South Florida. And most of it's being trucked in across the country from California. You know, all the produce, or even, you know, flown in and boated in from other countries around the world, because we have literally a diversified food system from big agribusiness that's growing all this food. And in my opinion, and based on some of the testing I've done, it tends to be lower quality food. So if you want to have an exceptional life, have a higher quality life, you need to eat higher quality food. And that's one of the reasons why I like the Swank Specialty Produce, is because Number one, they grow a lot of unique and different things you're never gonna find at the grocery store, even your whole paycheck food market, all right? Number two, they grow using high quality methods, right? They add things into the soils that most farmers don't even think about adding into the soils, such as trace minerals, whether that's in the form of ocean solids or ocean solution product, or whether that's in the form of different kinds of seaweed products or different rock-based products, leonardite, or different kinds of clays and whatnot. They're getting the trace minerals into the soil where they need to be so that the plants could now absorb these trace minerals. And when the plants have all the different nutrients they need, including, you know, minerals and bacteria and nutrients, they could grow to their full genetic potential, which means they're going to grow faster, they're going to grow larger, but more importantly for the end consumer like me and you, they're going to taste better too. And so what I thought I'd do in this episode, because I don't have a lot of time today, is we're just going to kind of tour you guys around actually how he's growing things. I mean, over the 17 years, Darren has just done the same thing and just repeated that year after year. He's always learning and growing. And as a gardener or farmer yourself, I want you to learn and grow each and every day, right? Try new and different things and see what works and what doesn't work. And you will learn better ways to do what you've done in the past, even if you thought you were doing it the best way previously. You could find even a better way. And we only will learn this by experimenting and trying things and finding out for you what works in your specific climate, your specific environment, because it's all different. I mean, I'm standing here for the last day. Actually, this is my last video coming from South Florida because tomorrow I fly back to the West Coast. But this is a very challenging growing environment. I mean, because there's no frost, there's bugs, all kinds of bugs year-round, right? More tropical bugs, right? And some of them could be really hard. Due to the weather, you know, most people think you can only grow during the wintertime here, which is the normal summer season for the rest of the U.S. And then in the summers, you take a break from growing because it's actually too hot to grow. That being said, if done properly, you could grow year-round here, but you need to dial in, you know, what you're growing and grow specific varieties, and more importantly, grow in different techniques and different styles so you can be successful. And that's what they've done here. Besides growing specialty produce and all kinds of produce, they're growing in two distinctive ways. You know, one is in soil-based medium, and the other is under a hydroponic system. And so I want to show you guys actually some of the crops that are growing, but also more importantly, you know, they are not certified organic here. But yet, you know, I would rather eat the food here that's not certified organic than certified organic food from Whole Foods, you know, that is certified organic, trucked and shipped in from California, because number one, this food is way fresher. They harvest it the day or the day before it's being sold generally. The other thing is that they don't use any kind of toxic sprays. They use only organic approved, pest controls, actually, including beneficial insects, as I have shown in previous episodes in their, a shade house over there where they could control the beneficial insects. And so there's no toxic sprays on these plants, although while they do use in this side of the farm predominantly organic fertilizers, the hydroponic area actually does not use entirely organic fertilizers. They use some organic fertilizers mixed in with the synthetic nutrients. And you know, people want to say it's bad if it's synthetic. Well, you know, I always say good, better, best, and I'd rather eat some synthetic nutrients, you know, in the hydroponics part of the farm that's actually supplemented with trace minerals. That's a very important distinction, instead of, once again, organic shipped in from California, even potentially worse, shipped in from Mexico, where you don't know the grower. They don't have like a policy where you could actually come and see the farm. I mean, here they have farm-to-table events all the time, which actually, if you guys live in the area, you might want to come out to, because then you could get a nice tour of the farm and also sample the produce being grown here on the farm in really cool, delicious meals. Actually, they just had one last night. I saw some cases of wine empty over there. So anyways, before it gets too dark, let's actually show you guys around some areas of the farm. So now I'm gonna walk you guys through just some of the farm. And as you guys can see, Darren is growing in a very specific way, right? He has basically all these little pots that are made out of plastic, you know? So basically he's growing all these are all little container plants that he's growing. And over on this side of the farm, actually, we calculated he has over 25,000 of those little plastic bag pots, right? That's a lot of plants to deal with. And you know, some of these pots, like over here with the eggplant, might have one plant per pot, you know, same with the peppers or tomatoes. But other ones like the beans, there are multiple plants per pot, and same thing when he does like, you know, beets and you know, other smaller crops. There's more than one plant per pot. Actually, I think the eggplant, sometimes there's two plants per pot. But yeah, this is some of the eggplant over here. We're getting in the tomatoes. So the tomatoes, these tomatoes are just about on their way out. As you guys can see, there's lots of tomatoes on here that they could probably still harvest. Maybe I'll try to eat a couple before I leave. Of course, the peppers, these peppers are looking amazing. Some nice, delicious, small snacking sweet peppers. And yeah, I mean, then we get into like just different kinds of leafy greens and all kinds of stuff he's growing. So I think the next thing, I'll set the camera down and we're gonna talk more about actually why he grows in the pots. So the cool thing about Darren is that he is actually very well, number one, experienced, right? Because he's been growing here for 17 years. And number two, he tends to read a lot. I mean, they take the summers, the hot summers off. They don't actually grow all year round like you could do. And that's because a lot of the people in this area actually aren't here in the summer, so they have less of a market to sell their products to. But also during that time, he does a lot of research and reading all these different, you know, agricultural magazines and information, does lots of research to really know and always every year up his game just a little bit more. You know, I know a lot of farmers are too busy to do that oftentimes, and he's always trying to like look for the next thing, you know, the next variety to grow, or to how to do something different and improve how he's growing. I mean, over here we got the Roselle, and these make the nice little buds here that has been used to like make tea. Like it's a hibiscus. You can also actually eat the little leaves that are kind of have like a sorrel or lemony flavor, and these look amazing. And you know, you guys could see the little pots down here that he's using, just the plastic bags that he's growing in. I mean, this is not rocket science. I mean, there's a few reasons he does this. Number one, he could control the soil mixture that he's putting in there. So he puts like a good organic mixture that has lots of organic matter in there to hold the roots and also to keep the microbes and the beneficial bacteria alive. He uses an organic style, a manure-based fertilizer in there to feed the plants, right? And you guys can see some of the amazing growth he has. And so another reason for that is he's controlling the mixture. Plus if it rains heavy or something like that, you know, all the nutrients stay in the bag, because I mean the sand here is literally soil and nutrients could wash out really fast. So he's controlling it by putting them in bags, and I think that's definitely a really good thing to do in the environment here. So continuing on with the tour, here's just more parts of the farm. Like I think in this area they're just planted some sugar snap peas, and they're kind of you know, he's always experimenting to find out what varieties do well or do worse, right? And just simply choosing a different variety of tomato or pepper or, you know, Brussels sprouts could be the difference between that crop producing for you here in South Florida, right, versus that crop not producing for you. So over the many years he's been growing produce, he's found the varieties that grow the best here in South Florida. And this is something that, you know, a new grower is not really going to know. And that could be ultimate success or failure for the farm, right? And I mean, he's run this farm successfully. So I mean, after 17 years, he wouldn't still be here if this farm wasn't pulling a profit. And you know, one of the things that Darren has to do is he has to constantly think, like when he's growing stuff, he's like, okay, how could I best utilize the space to maximize my return on the investment? You know, and generally beans are usually not a big part of the equation because beans are a very labor intensive crop. They make a lot of beans. You got to have a lot of labor to pick them. And you know, other crops are a lot easier to grow. I mean, lately, actually this row in the end there, he has actually cut flowers that he's growing, you know, and actually those have been doing quite well at the market for him. He has sunflowers that he's growing, you know, and actually all these little nice pepper plants, I think they're shishito peppers, right? Lots of little flower buds on there. And you know, shishitos are a much more valuable crop than say beans, because the shishitos sell for more dollars per pound. So it's really keyed in on really what it takes to grow a successful farm, right? And he knows how to do it, and the different crops to plant in this specific climate and area.
So as you guys can see behind me, they have actually a nice big barn structure here. And I think maybe last trip I was here they had this, but the trip before that they didn't actually have this. And you know, as a small farmer, right, and he has no corporations or anything backing him or anything like that, right, he's had to figure out how to make literally ends meet, because farming, especially here in South Florida where there's not such a demand, can be challenging, you know, because he has to sell the produce, and produce prices in stores are pretty expensive. So that, I mean, that's in favor, that's a good point in favor of him, that he could charge more for the crops, because there's, number one, not a lot of competition, and number two, prices here in South Florida just tend to be more expensive than other parts of the country I visited. But even then, selling the high and growing the highest quality and growing different varieties of things that people otherwise aren't growing, over and above that, he's had to figure out how to generate additional revenue, you know, from his farming. And so one of the ways he's found to do that is actually through agrotourism. So actually in the big barn looking thing behind me that's kind of open, they do farm to table events. Actually, they just had one last night. And you know, they get local chefs to come in and prepare food, and they use all the food produced on the farm primarily. And they just give people a nice a farm experience, because, you know, in this day and age, I think it's quite sad that most people don't know where food comes from. I mean, if you're a kid especially, you know that, you know, you see your parents buy food at the grocery store, you see your parents buy you McDonald's, and that's where food comes from. But food comes from Mother Earth, and it's really nice to come to a farm like Swank Farm and really see how everything is grown, actually under hydroponics, under, you know, the soil bags that I just showed you guys, and just learn more about how the food was grown, like the practices that are being used. You know, just because food's being grown, it doesn't mean it's being grown properly or the best way possible. In my opinion, Swank is actually growing some of the highest quality food I've seen, because they are using the trace minerals in both their processes, the organic pot side and also the hydroponic side that you'll see in a second. But more importantly, because they're using beneficial insects and not spraying the toxic pesticides that many farmers, unfortunately, may still use. So, I mean, it's important to minimize your risks of exposure from these potential toxins, you know, whatever they may be. So anyways, I think next I want to head into the shade house to show you guys actually how they're growing hydroponically, and actually lots of plants. It's totally insane. Probably, I don't even know how many, but they have a lot of tables and they have lots of different varieties of cool stuff growing that I got to taste earlier, and it really tastes so good. So now I'm going to walk you guys actually into the shade house here. And as you guys could see, like, there's a lot of weeds everywhere, you know, and hey, normally he would get the weeds chopped back, but this year they had that hurricane here in South Florida, and that really set him back like at least a month or two with everything that needed to get done. I mean, aside from just all the regular farming stuff, you know, they had to repair all the shade cloth up on the top, because there's like, it was ripped off, there was holes in it, and that took him like a month or two to just get it back in order and running. And I mean, and you could see all the different specialty crops he's growing. I mean, here's some like chives over here, and he's got like a different kind of basils and dills and catmint, and actually there's some wild arugula, and he's got edible flowers, edible marigolds over there. I see some edible nasturtiums. I mean, I could just be here all day showing you guys all the different things he's growing, and this is all under hydroponics, right? And so basically he has a nutrient solution that just basically is fed into these little gutters, and the plant roots just suck the nutrients up basically. And this is a really simple and easy, because this is all enclosed, this keeps the pests out. So actually he doesn't have to spray, because if there are no pests in here, he doesn't have to spray anything. And also, you know, in the past he has released pollinators in here, as well as beneficial insects to control the pests, you know, just through biological methods, which is really cool. Now this is an active farm, you know, so not everything is totally full and packed. They did just, you know, I have a market this weekend, so there's a lot of empty spots, plus he's still a little bit behind. But as you guys can see, you know, a lot of this is still really, really packed out and growing good food. So actually, let's go over and talk about some of the lettuces he's growing. So now we're looking at some of his hydroponic tables, and in this table, like, pretty much half of it is this nice red lettuce, and then the other half has some nice butter lettuce. He also has romaine and many different other varieties, right? And I would encourage you guys, when you guys go shopping or when you guys choose the lettuce to grow, I would encourage you guys actually to grow predominantly the red lettuces, you know. And here's the reason why, right? The red lettuces, if you guys could see, we're going to go ahead and carefully pick a leaf here. This leaf is predominantly like red or maybe even purple, depending on your color palette. But it's really deep, rich color. And the deep, rich color does two things. Number one, you know, this plant is more tolerant of the hot sun, especially here in South Florida. So this is like this is like smearing on sunblock. You know, the green plants don't have the sunblock because they're green, but this one, because it has all the purple, it's less likely to get sun damage. And then the cool thing about this is that when we eat it, that's some good lettuce, we get the purple pigments from the lettuce inside us, and that allows us to potentially fight off the sun, fight off disease, you know, fight off excess weight, and help regulate our blood sugar even better due to the anthocyanins in the lettuce. In addition, one of the things he's doing, I think most of the lettuce varieties he's growing are actually open head varieties. So the open head varieties, because they get more sun on the lettuce, they're going to produce more nutrients in the lettuce for you guys to eat, which then in terms of like a farmer or a chef, turns into better flavor as well. All right, now what I want to do is, let's see, we could do this carefully. We could go ahead and pull one of these lettuces up, very carefully, trying not to damage the roots here. But look at that. Here's a nice little lettuce with the roots on it. I mean, this plant is still alive. So that's one of the things I like about the hydroponics. I mean, literally with the lettuce, they could get pulled out really nice and easily. Next, I actually want to show you guys another benefit of growing under hydroponics. So another thing I want to show you guys actually about hydroponics is, you know, there's reasons why I like hydroponics and there's reasons why I don't like hydroponics, right? Nothing's ever really black and white in life, in my opinion. You know, there's never ever good or bad, and some people think, hydroponics, man, that's bad, it's not organic, you can't certify hydroponics organic. Well, that's a whole other topic of discussion, but there now have organic certified hydroponic grown foods coming on the market, and people would generally think that hydroponic food maybe has less nutrients than soil grown food. And you know, all I could say is that it depends on the methods that are being used to grow the soil grown food and the hydroponic food. Very important. But anyways, there's pros and cons to each. I'm not going to debate soil versus hydroponics. I mean, that's a whole video unto itself. If you guys want me to have a video like that, hey, post down below in the comments, let me know. Maybe I'll have a video like that one of these days. But there's pros and cons to each, right? But one of the pros of hydroponics is actually right here. We got mache, corn salad. I mean, in Europe, this stuff is actually quite popular. But you know, for those of you guys that grow it in your garden like I do, right? It's growing in my garden right now. The problem is the mache tends to grow very low to the ground. And then when you try to harvest it, you always get some dirt in with the mache. And it's kind of a pain. But in this situation, look, man, there's like no dirt. They have these like little sponges here, right down here. And here's the little root ball. There's no dirt. It's totally clean. And I mean, I could just literally harvest this whole thing and, you know, we'll tighten it all up and watch this. I ate it all. So as I was saying, I ate it all. And as you guys can see, I mean, this is very clean. I didn't get any dirt. I'm not eating dirt or particles or soil in my mouth. And all this mosh was actually really nice and tasty. And it's actually a lot easier to harvest this stuff than the stuff out of my garden with no dirt and, you know, no additional washing needed for me. Although, you know, I always encourage you guys to wash your produce if you see such a need. Anyways, I'm going to chew the rest of my mosh up. And actually, before it gets too dark, I'm going to catch up with Darren, the farmer here. Talk to him more about, you know, why he grows organically and actually why he grows just using synthetic nutrients in his hydroponic system, and actually how he's growing a better hydroponics by actually adding some of the trace minerals, and actually why he does that, and get a few other questions answered from the expert, master farmer Darren here. So now I'm here with Darren Swank, the owner and farmer here, along with his wife, a co-owner, of Swank Specialty Produce, that I got to tour around today. And the sun's going down really fast, so I wanted to really get through some questions with Darren, because I mean, literally he has been doing this for the last 17 years. He's an expert literally in his trade for growing in South Florida, because this is a whole beast unto itself. And I have some important questions for him today. So the number one question I have for you, Darren, is, you know, why do you grow organic on this side and use organic inputs on this side of the farm, but not on the side with the hydroponics?
Okay, John. Well, the short answer is because it works. But the long answer is it's just there has a good synergy between the hydroponics and the organic, in my opinion. You know, we're growing for profit. You know, the farm's a commercial farm. Farm's a business. So we're growing for profit. So growing leafy greens on the hydroponics, it just makes it a lot easier. You know, it's labor. Very expensive labor to grow this way. So it's off the ground, allows you to, you know, harvest easier, allows you to give you a longer shelf life. The product is outstanding. I grow on this side organically, so it allows me to use, you know, poultry-based manures to grow this fashion. The soils in South Florida are sand, so, you know, we get up off that sand because the organic nutrition doesn't work well in sand. So that's why we grow organically on this side, and that's why we grow hydroponic on this side.
Cool. And now the cool thing about your hydroponic growth on that side is that you're not just using hydroponic nutrients. What other things do you put in there to actually make the hydroponic nutrients even better than what most other hydroponic growers are probably not using?
Well, I mean, we start off with a basic hydroponic nutritional solution, and then to that we add clay. Clay has silicon in it, and silicon is very beneficial to plants. It gives them
backbone.
Yeah. Well, it gives them, you know, gives them strength against pests and diseases. It gives them better color. So we use that for that. Plus, the clays also have I don't know, maybe 62 elements in it. So it gives you an elemental diversification. And we also add ocean water. So if you harvest ocean water 2,000 feet down or so anywhere in the planet, it contains all the minerals on the planet. So we add that to the solution to give a diverse mineral package. The ocean water is supplemental, as if like a vitamin type of a situation in a human, and it adds a diversification of elements, and plants live on elements, and that's why we do that.
Cool. Yeah, and I mean, as you guys know that watch me for any length of time, I constantly stress the importance of the trace minerals that you're growing in your food in your garden. And if you're a farmer, you should be also adding them so that the food you're growing is more nutritious, you know, for your end consumer, and also they taste better too. And, you know, then we wouldn't need to take these vitamin supplements and mineral supplements because our food supply is deficient, because big agribusiness are not putting these small things in that don't cost so much extra money and can make a boost in growth and whatnot, because they've been doing the way they've been growing and they don't want to change. And actually that with Darren, I like that, because Darren, I mean, since you started 17 years ago, how many things have you changed on the farm?
That's a good question. I mean, I started off with three varieties. Diversification is the key in South Florida. So, I mean, I diversified tremendously. The original format with growing hydroponic on the table is still here. I had the vision of, you know, that I needed to, not everything grows hydroponic on the table, it's nutrient film technique. So I knew that I was gonna have to use another format to grow the other veg. So that's where the bags came in for the production on that. So, I mean, you know, I don't think a lot of things have changed from the production standpoint, but I've just added so much more diversification. And the diversification is what gives us strength in the subtropical climate.
So Darren, you know, I know that by adding some of the different nutrients in your growing medium and whatnot makes a better flavor, but what does that mean in terms of nutrition?
Well, I mean, nutrition equals flavor. And most folks don't understand that, but it does. Like the vitamins, minerals, phytochemicals, they all taste like something on your tongue. So when you consume those elements or any of those properties, it's blasting your tongue off. So when you have those properties in your food and you taste it, it has flavor. So it tastes like something. So when you consume vegetables that are grown close to your locale and grown properly, you have so much flavor. So flavor equals nutrition, and that's the basis of it. So when you consume, I mean, I hate to go to the store bought stuff, but when you buy stuff through the normal supply chain, either the product wasn't, you know, the nutrition wasn't in it originally, or it was oxidized out over time, because there's a big gap between harvest and consumption. And so you lose a lot of the properties of the food that you're consuming. So that's why it's very important to try to source your food locally.
Right. And by locally, I think backyard. You could grow it in your backyard. But if you're not going to do that, then hey, if you live in South Florida, come to Darren, because he's growing some high quality food. So Darren, another thing that I want to talk about before the sun goes down, actually, and we're losing time fast, is, you know, I know since I was here last, you've done some major, actually, dietary changes, right?
True.
So do you want to share with people, like, what you've done with your diet and actually why?
Well, I you know, I've always been slightly overweight. You know, different points of my life have been more or less. And then I was trying to figure out, you know, I'm not even sure how I even decided to do it, but I decided to change my diet because I figured I needed to or whatever. So I flip-flopped my diet from eating a lot of protein, land and sea-based, to more plants. Mm. I mean, like you. So
well, I'm like all plants.
No, that's true. But in any case, instead of eating, say, 80% protein, land and sea, and 20% plants, I flopped it. So I now eat probably 80% plant-based materials and 20% land and sea, you know, proteins. And to me, you can't beat that. And plus, planning out your food consumption instead of eating three heavy meals a day, just kind of eating slowly throughout the course of the day, so you're never really hungry. So you're constantly, you know, adding calories in as you're burning them off, so you never really gain a hunger. And then, and to me, you shed pounds that way.
Wow, yeah, I mean, it's amazing just walking around with Darren earlier. We were just walking through and we were both grazing on the food here. I mean, we would be natural grazers and he has a whole farm to eat off of. So I think that's really great. I mean, the thing is, I think the standard American diet, you know, with 80% protein, which is, you know, let's face it, animal-based, and 20% vegetables, if that, and most of the vegetables people eat are like white potatoes, right? There's a big problem with that. And I mean, there's all these subsidies that the governments are given to, you know, farmers to grow grains, which then end up to feed the cows to make the meat so that people can continue on this 80-20% diet. And meanwhile, these subsidies are not helping out small farmers like Darren. They're helping like big agri companies, you know, grow all these grains that, in my opinion, and based on research, to grow, whether it's grain to make bread out of or bread products or bakery products, or whether that's to go to the animals, you know, that's not the healthiest way to live. And I'm glad that, you know, just simply by swapping his diet, you know, to 80-20 the other direction, eating plants 80 and animal products and other, you know, proteins at 20% can make a significant difference in your diet. And I would encourage you guys, wherever your guys at, is to, you know, number one, get rid of the processed junk foods. I mean, you know, it's processed food, you know, it's junk food. It's not good for you. It could accelerate aging and potentially cause disease. And same thing with animal products. Too much animal products has been proven to cause disease. So I'm not saying cut it out completely like I do. You know, you could do that if you want. But, you know, just take a step in the right direction to eat more plants, save more animals, and, you know, eat less animals, right? And that's the best way to do it. So, Darren, how do you think if people did this, if the whole country went 80-20, like 80% plants, 20% animals, what do you think would happen to people?
Well, I mean, I think health issues would be greatly reduced. There's no doubt about that. And I think environmentally we'd be better off. I mean, the food supply could be more locally based instead of like being shipped cross continentals or what have you. Although, you know, I just think it's going to be a lot better. It's going to resolve a lot of problems that we have in the country. That's what I think.
Yeah, I mean, I would agree with that. I mean, I've seen by going to a plant-based diet myself, like I rarely ever get sick. I don't get colds, all these crazy things that I used to deal with. I don't get stomach aches. I mean, oh my God, I don't appreciate how much I miss stomach aches until for some random reason I get a stomach ache. And I mean, before I did major dietary changes, I'd get stomach aches all the time. And when I go to the bathroom, this is kind of gross and it might be too much information, but when I go to the bathroom, because I eat so much fiber, you know, I'm in the bathroom, you know, it's like a minute or two, I do my business and I leave the bathroom. I'm not sitting there for 20 minutes pushing and all this stuff, man. That's unknown to me. I don't have to have magazines in my bathroom to read because I'm just done so fast. I could barely read a sentence or a paragraph and I'm just out of there, right? So you could have more time to garden and do other things in life than sit on the pot, man. So Darren, the sun's almost down. Are there any other final comments or words of wisdom you'd like to share with my viewers today?
Well, eat more plants, I guess, right?
Eat more plants, and more importantly, grow more plants or support your local farmer like Darren. If you guys here in South Florida, oh, I got another question for you actually before we go, before it gets too dark, is, you know, I know you're really big on education, and I think one of the problems in today's society is that people do not understand the difference between lettuce that was grown here and harvested fresh here versus lettuce from the store. They think lettuce is lettuce is lettuce. What do you think could be done to help educate people and kind of switch them to know the difference between, you know, like a good lettuce versus a bad lettuce? Because most people always eat bad lettuce and that's what they expect and that's what they know.
Well, I mean, I guess to letting them taste it, that's the first way, I would imagine. I mean, because when you consume the lettuces that are here or any place that's being grown locally, there's such a vast difference. You know, when we eat lettuce, our food, all season long through the winter down here, and then we go into the summer months where we don't have it, we eat the store-bought stuff, and it's such a letdown. And all summer long, we go through it, and we complain and bitch the whole summer. And then when it comes back into the fall, and we start getting our first crops of consumption again. It's just such a relief, you know. The only way I guess is allowing them to consume the food, you know. And that's the best education, I suppose. Yeah.
Well, so maybe you should have like a food test day and invite people to the farm and have, you know, store-bought stuff and your stuff side by side and just for free, let people taste it so that you could convert them, really. Or I mean, if you're home, you're not here at the farm to be able to taste the stuff they grow here, is grow your own stuff and harvest it fresh. And I mean, all you guys that are my gardeners that have been watching me for a while, you guys know what a homegrown tomato tastes like. It tastes amazing, and then you buy the store-bought one, they're like flavorless, right? But every food is like that, whether it's lettuce, tomatoes, kale, okra, I mean, even fruits, right? Homegrown fruits picked at their peak of ripeness are way better than the you know, fruits that are picked too early and then shipped and packed and in cold storage, you know, for sometimes half a year, right? So super critical, super important. And I want to encourage you guys, if you guys haven't tried farm fresh grown food, visit your local farmers market, come out to your local farms, join your local CSA, or even better yet, grow food in your backyard, you know, so you could taste the difference. And then you will be a convert, and then you will like live your life as one of your primary goals is to eat the highest quality food. Not only is it more tasty, but it's also more nutritious, so you could have greater health benefits. And of course, hopefully at the same time, you'll start eating more of it and getting rid of the junk food, the processed food, and the animal foods in excess, however, whatever amount, you know, you feel that is. So yeah, before I get bit to heck from all these mosquitoes here, how can somebody purchase from you guys, Darren? How can somebody get a hold of your farm and all this stuff?
Well, they can go to the website, probably the easiest way, www.swankspecialproduce.com.
Yep. Awesome.
All right. Facebook, Instagram, same thing.
Cool. I'll put links down below so you guys can learn about Darren's farm and you know all the produce he grows here. I would encourage you guys, if you live in South Florida looking for a good source of high quality produce, you definitely want to check these guys out. They definitely got the stuff. All right. So anyways, before I get bit and get like West Nile virus, please be sure to thumbs this video up if you liked it. I'll come back to Swank next time next time I'm in town. Also be sure to share this video with somebody else. If you know somebody else in South Florida looking for a good quality and good source of food, share this video with them so they could learn about Swank specialty produce here. Also be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you don't miss out on any of my new and upcoming episodes. I've come out every 3 to 4 days. You never know where I'll show up or what you'll be learning on my YouTube channel. And finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are a wealth of knowledge, over 1,300 episodes at this time, teach you guys all aspects on how you guys can grow your own food at home. And I'll put links down below in the description to all the videos I made in Florida that can help you guys out specifically, because Florida, South Florida, is a place unique unto itself, and you got to use certain techniques and grow certain plants. Otherwise, in my opinion, you'll fail miserably, and this guy's got it all figured out. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time, and until then, remember, keep on growing.